Rani Vikram Singh.
I have a privilege. After that, you can go to the main debate. I have no problem.
Yes, sir.
I must thank you for giving me the time. I am raising an issue, question of the powers, privilege of this house concerning it. As I told you, the failure to notify the house on an arrest of a member of parliament and the failure to notify parliament on the need to question an MP already appearing before a presidential commission of inquiry. These are violations of the privilege of the house, not only of the members. The Honourable Harin Fernando is a very vocal critic of the government in this house. The police attempted to interrogate him on a statement made by his father, which was already examined by the Presidential Commission of Inquiry, and thereafter take him into custody. This was prevented by an order of the Supreme Court. A similar issue has come up in connection with Honourable Rishad Badudin, a violation of the need for notification. Powers of this House is unique. Article 3, Article 4, which gives the legislative power of the people to us, Article 69(1), where the parliament consists of 225 members elected by the people, is the body that is in charge with the grave duty of legislating and supervising the government. Therefore, members of parliament, if parliament is to function, the members cannot be subject to any pressure or intimidation. This is a principle which came from 1642, when Speaker Lenthal told King Charles I, "May it please your majesty, I have neither eyes to see nor tongue to speak in this place, save as the house directs me, whose servant I am here." Now this led to a civil war, where the parliament won and the king was executed. That is how this was brought in. Then thereafter, we also have the powers of the privileges of parliament under section article 67, and thereafter we can act according to the Section 7 of the Parliamentary Privileges Act. Parliament and members thereof hold, enjoy, and exercise such and like immunities as are for the time being held, enjoyed, and exercised by the Common House of Parliament of the United Kingdom and the members thereof. Therefore, this Parliament can exercise the same immunities as the United Kingdom House of Commons, which can be enforced under Article 4C to safeguard the ability of this House to function free of executive pressure on its members in the exercise of the legislative power of the people. So first let me deal with the question of Mr. Harin Fernando. The facts are that the previous night he rang me on the day of the explosion and told me that his sister had told him that morning that the previous night his father had said that not to go to church and to be careful, there can be trouble. Now, what are we talking? Let's presume that Mr. Harin Fernando's father gave the information. If the police didn't act on information given by the Indian intelligence services, do you think they are going to act on what was said by Mr. Harin Fernando's father? All the information was there. The next morning the Indians gave the information. So when all that information was there and they didn't act on it, do you think the police was going to act? I know that. I am telling you the facts. So let me finish it, will you? Do you think the police that was going to act on what Mr. Fernando was going to say, which would have found out from some police officer? So that means this is a... So if you now come to question him on a matter which is not relevant, which has been dealt by a presidential commission of inquiry, there is only one conclusion. They want to intimidate him. And Erskine May has said, attempts to influence members in their conduct by threat is a breach of parliamentary privilege. So this is an intimidation of a member which violates the privilege of the House. The failure to provide, and it also means it's a failure to provide the correct information to the Speaker. They said we want to question on these issues, but the fact is that it has already been done and finished. And the inquiry was why the police didn't act. So they gave the Speaker and the House the false information. Then I want to come on to the next issue, which is the arrest of MPs who are part of the House of Commons, their privileges and immunities. So I would like to deal with it. Firstly, the Speaker of the House of Commons gave a ruling on 3rd of March 1959, Volume 601, Column 226, the origin of the doctrine of freedom from arrest, which attaches to all members of Parliament during a session of Parliament, lies in the fact that this House is entitled to have a first claim upon their services, and that any person who by an action of arrest or hindrance prevents a member from attending in his place to do his duty is guilty of contempt of the whole House. Then I would also like to point out what Blackstone said at that time. The chief, if not the only privilege of Parliament in such cases, seems to be the right of receiving immediate information of the imprisonment or detention of any member with the reasons for which he is detained. So that basically is a very, very old right which has been exercised by members in the House. So I am only asking that this be followed. I'd like to deal a little bit, if the House gives me, on the requirement of privilege. I think in the article I gave Honourable Speaker, it's well there, but I'm reading for the information of the House. Erskine may state that in all cases in which members of either House are arrested on criminal charges, the House must be informed of the cause for which they are detained from their service in Parliament. It comes from there. Then, before Erskine may, the parliamentary privilege was referred to by Mr. John Hatzell. He says, it is highly expedient that whenever public necessity appears for the ministers of the Crown to justify any breach of the privilege, they should as soon as possible acquaint the House with the steps they have taken and the grounds and reasons. Furthermore, Erskine may again says, thus the House will not allow even the sanctuary of its walls to protect a member from the process of criminal law. We accept that. But in all cases in which members are arrested on criminal charges, the House must be informed of the cause for which they are detained from their services in Parliament. The House therefore continued to insist on notification even while it made no attempt to claim immunity for its members from the due process of the criminal law. For instance, the Protection of Persons and Property Bill of 1881, a controversial legislative proposal which provided for a form of detention without trial, was amended on its passage through the House to make express provision for the notification of the House in event of arrest of any members under its provisions. The principles on which the privilege of freedom from arrest is based is the absolute priority of attendance by members of both Houses. However, it has never been allowed to interfere with the administration of criminal justice or emergency legislation. The privilege is now extremely limited application. So that is how it's done. We don't ask exemption from arrest, but what we say is that it should be informed to the House. Then I'd like to refer to an emergency case. During World War II, the British Parliament passed the Emergency Powers Defence Act 1939, and regulations were made to detain people who have a serious threat to the country. One member of Parliament called Captain Ramsay, who also belonged to a club called the Right Club, which had a lot of people sympathetic to Germany, he was arrested by the orders of the then Prime Minister Winston Churchill. But after they arrested and detained, I'd like to read out to you how the House proceeded. Can I read out from the House of Commons debate of 30th July 1940. Captain Shaw, member, asked the Prime Minister whether he has considered the motion standing on the order paper relating to the detention of honourable and gallant member for Peebles and Southern, Captain Ramsay, and whether the government will refer the matter to the Committee of Privileges. The Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, yes, sir. The government are prepared to move to refer the question of arrest and detention of the honourable and gallant member for Peebles and Southern to the Committee of Privilege for examination in relation to the privilege of the House. The necessary motion will be tabled tomorrow. Then the next day, a motion is tabled that the Committee of Privileges do consider and report whether the detention of Captain Ramsay under Regulation 180 of Regulation 18B of the Defence General Regulation 1939 constitutes a breach of privilege of this House, and it is moved by the Deputy Prime Minister, Mr. Clement Attlee. So that's how they have gone in England. Even if a member is taken in, he has to be it has to be inquired into. And I must tell you, Honourable Speaker, the committee went into it and they found that one of the supporters of Captain Ramsay, who worked in the American embassy, had taken secret correspondence between Prime Minister Churchill and President Roosevelt and gave it to Captain Ramsay, who was about to pass it on to the German embassy in Dublin. So the House said his detention was justified. So that is the way in which the House comes, and we have messenger, a member is detained, it goes in and it looks into the matter. So now thereafter, all this was codified by the standing order of the House of Commons in 2016, but it was all brought into the standing orders of the House of Commons Public Business 2019. And there at the very end, you find, if you don't mind, the new rule which applies here, and which comes under the appendix, notification of arrest of members. And what they say there is that member of the House shall be under no undue restraint from being able to attend the House, and this principle has been and continue to be encompassed in the privilege of the House claimed at the beginning of each Parliament. So these are the immunity ordered that this House accordingly endorses the second report of the Procedures Committee, Session 2015-16, notification of the members, directs the clerk of the House and the Speaker to follow the protocol on notification of the arrest of members set out in Annex 2 of that report. I have given you a copy, but for the benefit of the members, I will read the first item on the annexure, because I think that is what is most important. The protocol on handling of notification arrest, which should come here. The police forces in UK should, as soon as possible, and in any event within 24 hours of arrest, notify the Chief Superintendent at Parliament of any case in which a member has been arrested or similarly detained, showing when and where the arrest took place, where and for how long the member was detained, when and on what basis released, and the offence cited. What is the offence? They have to be informed of what is the offence. So these immunities apply to us. These are exemptions from the normal arrest rules, but under Privileges Act, Section 7. So there we have the case of Honourable Richard Bathudeen, the member. So far, no reason has been given as to why he is under detention. So the right of the Parliament to know why he's been detained has been violated. There has been order under the Prevention of Terrorism Act, Section 9, a detention order made. This is the way that you all learn about standing orders of the House. Learn that, you study it. If you want another day, certainly come and reply. I like you all to follow the process. It's a bad this thing for the House. So therefore, what are you saying? They are talking about unlawful activity. That is defined in Section 39, which was again amended in 1988. That's unlawful activity referred to there or in any other law. So if you look at the unlawful activity in the in relation to the Prevention of Terrorism Act, it says person who causes the death of a specified person or kidnaps, so there have been no specified person that we are aware of, causes the death of any person who is a witness to any offence, commits a criminal intimidation of a specified person, commits the offence of robbery or property of government, any department, commits the offence of mischief to property of the government, without lawful authority, imports, manufacture, collect firearms, possess without lawful authority firearms, by words either spoken or read by signs or by intention, he has tried to cause violence, religious or racial, communal disharmony. He has erased, mutilates, defaced or otherwise interferes any word harbors, conceals, or in any other manner prevents, hinders, or interferes the apprehension of proclaimed person. I don't think he has interfered with any specified person. There are no specified person to begin with. And therefore, I don't know what exactly this offense is. Then you must remember the preamble. Preamble says, whereas public order continues to be endangered by elements or groups of person or associates that advocate the use of force or the commission of crimes as a means or as an aid in encompassing governmental change within Sri Lanka. I can't think of him trying to use force to change the government of which he is a minister. I mean, basically, yeah, that doesn't fly. So what has happened here is that the member has been detained without the reasons being given. And therefore, it's a violation of the rights of this house. And then it's a detention to which the exemptions of members being arrested and kept and when the charges are notified doesn't apply. He can tomorrow walk out free. There's very little anyone can do if you go to courts. So since it doesn't come under the Prevention of Terrorism Act, then he is not under the exemption where you have waived the right not to arrest, because that's a very narrow one. It has the right and then the notifications, how it should be done to the house. It's a privilege of the house. So in that case, I think the whole the rights of the house and of the member both have been violated, and the notification rules of UK, which is in their standing orders, honourable member, should apply to this house now. We only go on criminal proceedings. But these outside criminal proceedings. The another question is, can a member be detained under PTA? If you look into Article 3, Article 4, Article 69, and can Section 9 of the PTA apply there? Because the PTA was passed after the Constitution. So PTA has not overridden the Constitution. PTA must work in accordance with the rights there. Then, I don't know where we, who are the supreme, who are the representative of the people, can be taken in this way. In the world, the PTA has never been used to detain any members. So I think it has to be exercised. Even the public security ordinance, where emergency legislation and people can be detained in relation to a member of parliament, it has to be exercised under Article 3, Article 4, Article 67, and Article 69. So I have raised this issue because I think the parliament, if you have to safeguard parliament, we must safeguard its rights, we must safeguard its members, and also we must safeguard the powers of a cabinet, because the cabinet ultimately is responsible to parliament. So I would like you to go into this and give a ruling on it at whatever time you think is appropriate. But I'd also like to request that you do take this matter up, and we can also refer it to the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association and the International Parliamentary Union. Thank you.
Well, Amit Tuma.
Point of order.
The Honourable Ranil Wickremesinghe, when he was the Prime Minister, by violating the Constitution, he has formed the FCID. When he was the Prime Minister, by violating the Constitution, he had formed the Dushan Mardana Ekaka. And I must ask whether he has already read the Erskine at that time. So the thing is this, I think, Yat Kisima. සදාචාරාත්මක අයිතියක් නැහැ මන්ත්‍රීවරුන්ගේ අයිතිය ගැන කතා කරා. ඉතින් ඒක නිසා රිෂාඩ් බද්දුවින් සම්බන්ධයෙන් ඔහු අත්අඩංගුවට ගත්තේ ඔහු මන්ත්‍රීවරයෙක් නිසා නෙමෙයි, ඔහු අත්අඩංගුවට ගත්තේ ඔහුගේ යම් මේ සිද්ධීන් තිබෙන නිසා. නම් ඒක දැන් නීතිපතිවරයාට යොමු කරලා තියෙනවා. හරියන් ප්‍රදන්දු මන්ත්‍රීවරයා අත්අඩංගුවට ගන්න කිසිම සැලැස්මක් තිබ්බේ නැහැ. ඔහු කිව්වා මහමලුකරුවෝ දන්නවයි කියලා. මහමලුකරුවෝ දන්නවනම් ජාතික ආරක්ෂාව දෙසා ඔහුගේ යුතුකමක් තියෙනවා අපරාධ පරීක්ෂණ දෙපාර්තමේන්තුවට ඇවිල්ලා පැටවර කරන්න. ඒක කියන්න නැත්තම් කවන්නේ.
හරි. ඔව්.
යන්නේ මල්ලේපොල්. මේ පළමුවෙන්ම මේ ගැන කතා කරන්න වුවමනා නම් මං හිතන්නේ අවස්ථාව තියෙනවා. මං දැක්ක අපේ න්‍යාය පත්‍රයේ තියෙනවා
ප්‍රශ්නයක්
අර अभेरत्न कमीशन
former prime minister's statement I was very carefully listening sir it's good for studying but the thing is the irony is you have come to one seat
all right they are no
sir give me some opportunity order. because
I am speaking
please
no can I finish
you go ahead sir
all I am saying is I have presented to you all the relevant material if there are counter material that can be presented I have nothing I am not saying to do it today so you certainly bring that in and secondly I like members of parliament to go study this come back because the opportunity for all the new members to learn and if they can find new material to refute me all the better but I don't think getting up here and shouting is a main this house must conduct itself in a way that we gain the trust of the public members of the government may agree with me they may not agree with
me no point of order there
they know they need to know so all this time this house I must whether they agree with me or not this house was able to sit down and listen to it mama kiyanne
right
diniyak da ganna meka ara ganma ekak kiyanna as far on ara me pastu irida mamai hitiye mata issella me gana kiwwe harin fernando ඇමතිතුමා මට කතා කරලා කිව්වා මේක හරි වැඩක් මගේ නංගි මට අද කිව්වා මගේ නංගි මට අද කිව්වා ඊයේ තාත්තා නංගිට කිව්වා කියලා මෙහෙම කරදරයක් ඇති වෙයි කියලා ඉතින් මම ඒක කියන්නේ මගෙන් අහන්නකෝ තව මේකක් වැඩ නැහැ මටනේ
ඉස්සෙල්ලා දැන් අපි ඔකට ඉවරකට ආයෙ තු නැහැ
මේකයි තියෙන්නේ
එතන ගරු මන්ත්‍රීතුමා
ඔය ගියේ එකක්වත් එදා උදේ ඉන්දියාවේ තොරතුරු ඇවිල්ලා මේක කරේන